So I guess over the last couple of days, you've been hearing a lot of stories about integration. And usually when we talk about enterprise integration, it's usually the heavy-duty stuff. You've got a lot of talk about integrating with your customers, with your partners, with your suppliers, creating digital platforms, running billions of transactions a day. But I like to focus today more in terms of what's more closer to you, your day-to-day business operations, what happens within your own departments, within your own teams, because there's also some level of IT that you use on a day-to-day basis, right? So just want to check if you actually, is it optimized for efficiency? Is it optimized for cost? And most importantly, is it optimized for the user experience in basically your team? Right, so if you look at how IT evolves within any enterprise, right? So at the start, when you actually start an organization, you'll start your business, you'll probably have just a couple of systems. You'll just be doing email, do some collaboration, some spreadsheets, whatever. You might have some. you'll probably buy some packages. You'll probably build your own, and then eventually, over time, you'll subscribe to some SaaS type offerings. And over time, over a few years, you'll have a plethora of information systems in an organization of all shapes and sizes, right? You'll have customer relationship management, enterprise content management, ERPs, business intelligence, etc. But if you look at, take a step back and think about this now, the systems that you have put in place over the years now, it doesn't really follow a blueprint that you really wanted to have at the start of when you actually launched your business, right? So things just fall into place eventually. So you will have, after a couple of years, you'll have your head of sales, for example, come and say, okay, now I want some budget to get a CRM system because I can't deal with a spreadsheet anymore to manage my sales records. And then a few months or a couple of years later, your head of finance will come and say, I want some budget to have a finance or a billing system because I can't be raising bills and invoices on Word documents anymore. And so eventually what happens is you'll start getting all these systems coming into place, and you will have a set of systems that really work in the individual silos. You'll have billing, you'll have a people management system for HR, you'll have something to manage your travel, etc. And you'll have a certain set of systems, some on the cloud, some on-premise, etc. But the thing is, if you take a step back and look at this again, are these systems really working together? Because honestly, to achieve your business, your business objectives and goals, there has to be information flowing through these systems, right? There has to be some kind of orchestration happening from basically concept to market to invoicing to cash. And as soon as there's some kind of that these systems can't talk to each other in any way, then that means there's some manual intervention that's required. And as soon as there's manual intervention required, then what happens? Then obviously there's human error that comes into play. So it's unavoidable, right? You'll have the best people, but it's probably, there will be errors happening. And as soon as you have errors, then there's rework. Obviously, it affects your efficiency, it affects your cost. There's blame, there's going to be complaints, there's going to be, frustration setting in your people, which is, it's an important factor. And then there'll be people who think, okay, I should be adding much more value, because computers are supposed to do all this stuff, but why am I doing all these mundane tasks now? Right? So then obviously you have to think about fixing this. And it's something probably, if you start looking at the whole external view, we often tend to neglect this or it gets ignored. But if you look at the internal picture, you need to do something about it, especially if you're not going to scale and we're not growing your business. So one option is, to spend a couple of million pounds or euros and go and get a nice flashy ERP type system or some kind of fully fledged system that will do everything for you, right? So that is a fully integrated system. But then it's almost guaranteed that there will be no system that really you can just work with, right? It will, because all of your businesses, the way you do your work will have some form of, something will be unique, which means you'll need to go and customize your software and then spend more money on that. Or your other option then is to go and build a bespoke solution. Again, it's going to take some time, it's going to take money, and if you don't have the necessary skills to manage that whole effort, then it's going to be a nightmare to get it out. So if you have individual systems that do what they're supposed to do in their individual silos, you don't actually need to look further. You don't need to look at, you know, spending all these millions of pounds or euros. If you can really figure out a way to get your systems, the systems that you already have, talking to each other. Right? So basically, if there's a way that you can integrate your existing systems, then you can try and make that information flow through that integration into your systems and basically automate some of these scenarios that are being done manually now. Right? So it's now my turn to tell you some stories, and this time it's the stories of how we integrate within WSO2 itself, using because we build integration products, but we are also a business, we are an enterprise. We have, you know, people records to manage, we have invoices to raise, we have customer records to manage, we have travel to manage, so we also have a IT footprint within our business. So we will encounter the same issues that you will encounter in any enterprise. So basically, we will go into some stories and some in terms of what we do within our business, within WSO2, to do integrations internally. And the best part of it is we use our own dog food. We eat our own dog food to do all the integrations that we do. So it's not only the products. When it comes, when I say dog food, we use our products as much as possible for our internal integrations. We also use the consulting services that we offer to you as customers as a development service or some kind of a consulting service. We use that consulting model to allocate people for the month or two to do this integration work. And then when we come to the next project, we allocate someone else. And not only that, we also use our own support model. So basically the same support process that you follow, logging a ticket in Jira and following it through, same protocol, same communication models. We use that same protocol as well for our internal integration. So basically when we say eating our own dog food, it's the products, it's the services, and it's the support process as well. Right? So this is just a glimpse of our enterprise footprint at WSO2 at the moment. So we have Google Apps for everything, from email to, you know, all our documents to calendar. Everything is managed on Google. We have Salesforce for CRM. We are using People HR for our people management. Jira, obviously, if you're already a customer, you're already familiar with Jira for raising support tickets. NetSuite for financials. Jenkins for build. We're just implementing Pardot now for our marketing campaigns, Zora for billing. And we also have a set of internal applications that we built using, again, a lot of our own stuff. So it's a growing footprint, IT footprint. So using this, now, obviously, there are a lot of systems here. And obviously, we are going to have a lot of issues that all of you all will have when you have several systems working within your organizations. So let's look at a few scenarios scenarios within our organization and what we've done to integrate and automate and, you know, provide a better user experience to our team. Right? So the first one is too many passwords. So this is something I'm sure all of you are familiar with. As soon as you have multiple systems in place, you will have multiple username password requirements from each of these systems, right? So you will have one system saying I want email address as the username and then password as an alphanumeric character set, or then another system will want just a numeric PIN. Another system will say I just want your name as the username. So when this happens, what people usually do is, it's impossible to remember all these usernames and passwords. So people will start writing usernames, passwords on post-it notes, paste it on the laptop, or put it on a notepad and put it in the drawer, or on their phone, or what's going to happen is they're going to forget the username and password, and it's just going to be a lot of support requests. So what we've done is, so as you see, we have two sets of applications. We have the internal-facing applications. This is for our team. And then, you know, given that we are a community-based organization, for our customers and our partners, we have a set of applications that they need to log into. And we have our own people who need to log into them as well. So we've implemented WSO2 Identity Server. And through Identity Server, now we implemented single sign-on to these applications. So I, as a user, my user ID is shevan@wso2.com. And with wso2.com and the associated password, I can log into all of the applications in the organization now. And not only that, when I'm logged into one of the applications, I'm automatically logged into everything else. So I don't need to go and log into each of these applications individually now. Right, so and we are in the process of implementing federation because of the two, the external facing and the public facing sites, we're implementing two identity servers so that when external application gets a login request from a user, if it identifies it as an internal user, there'll be some kind of federation happening where it'll redirect it to the internal identity server and log them through to the systems here. We're also implementing auto provisioning. So when a new person joins the company, we will be able to provision him to all the systems he needs automatically. So if he's an engineer, he will get access to all the engineering systems he needs without you having to go and create accounts in each of these systems. At the same time, if he leaves the company, it's just going to be a single operation. You remove him from your main identity server and he gets deprovisioned from all the systems. So it's basically improving the efficiency around our whole or the authentication within the company. So that's the first example. So this is another example where we've done automation now. So we use Zora billing for our cloud platform. So as you know, we have API manager in the cloud now. So every time a new user logs in, his bills are generated on Zora. So what used to happen is every time a new billing record is created in Zora, someone used to have to go and manually create a record in Salesforce because that's where we track our sales bookings. And then also someone has to go and create a record in NetSuite because that's where we track our revenue. But this, I mean, at the time we launched the cloud platform, it was just a few users, but it's not scalable, right? If it's on the cloud, eventually it can be thousands of users. And it's not scalable at all for someone to go and do this manually on a day-to-day basis. So what we did was this. So we basically integrated the three applications using Enterprise Service Bus. We are using our ESB connectors that we have in place. So basically, every time a new record is created in Zora now, there'll be a record automatically created in Salesforce and a record automatically created in NetSuite. So there's some logic built in there now to check if it's an already existing customer, then we just need to update a record, otherwise we need to create a new record. So this basically, it's going to really help us when we start scaling on the cloud platform because of the potential manual effort otherwise. So third example, what we've been doing. So as you know, as part of our offerings, we have our support business, and we also have a consulting business, so where we allocate people into client engagements to come and do some kind of development service or the quick start or the training engagement with our customers, or also support as well. So at the moment, so this is something that's still ongoing. We haven't completed the automation effort here. So what happens is account manager, the manual process that happens now, account manager will create a record in Salesforce and say, okay, we've closed the deal on this, we've signed the contract, and now we need to allocate someone to go and deliver that service. Right? So the account manager at the moment needs to go and fill a Google form, and that Google form will say, okay, this person, we need a consultant to travel to this country from this date to this date to provide service to this customer, and this is the scope of the engagement. And then that gets emailed out to a team that manages the whole allocation process. And what they do then is they take that information from the email, they put it into a spreadsheet as their main source of tracking all this information. And then once it's in the spreadsheet, there's a process of consultant clearance where there's emails flying around saying, okay, consultant X, are you able to travel on this date? He says no, then so you ask the next consultant. If he's okay to travel, then we generate a travel request, which is again another email, and that email will then go into another spreadsheet, which the travel folks will manage. And once the travel is done, once the flights are booked, once the hotel is booked, and all that is booked, then they will send the email to the person who's traveling, saying, "Okay, your travel is now confirmed." But if you look at it, when we come here, there's so much of information loss because of the amount of manual steps involved, right? And it takes a long time. There have been instances where we don't know by the time it comes here, by it comes to travel, you don't know which country. Sometimes you got it wrong. Sometimes there have been duplicates. And it becomes a major nightmare for the finance team to track the cost here now. Because we don't know, sometimes the project name is missing. If the project name is missing, we don't know which project to allocate that cost to. So it's basically that whole orchestration when it comes in that because of the manual intervention that's in place, there's information loss and so much of redundancy happening there. So again, it's not going to work for us as we scale. So what we are going to do now is we're just going to remove that whole process, the whole manual intervention. We've developed a consultant allocation application. We've developed this as a it's basically a WSO2 jaggery app sitting on WSO2 application server. So within this application, there's some business process. We are using a business process server because there's some state and workflow to be managed there. So what this will basically do is it will handle everything from Salesforce to consultant clearance. All that manual process, there will be still some manual intervention because you need to make sure that it's the right consultant. We don't have that intelligence built in to make sure that it's the exact person that needs to go, but there has to be some manual intervention for someone to go and check, okay, is this the right person? But we will be able to see, get at least the pool of people who are going to, who are available for engagement now. So what will happen now is in Salesforce, we have introduced a button for that particular, so that the account manager can just go and click the button. All the information that would have usually gone into the Google form just gets pumped into the consultant allocation application. And the consultant selection process will happen there. And we've also built another travel application, which again, we could have actually, we actually started as a combined application, but we separated it out because it's managed by a different team. Which is again another jaggery application sitting on application server. So what will happen is once the consultant allocation is confirmed, automatically the records gets added into the travel application now. So that whole orchestration now happens automatically. There's no information loss, and the whole context is now transferred right throughout. And so the travel application is now used by the travel team. Once they go and do the flight bookings, the hotel accommodation bookings, etc., there's an automatic notification. Once the process is completed, the automatic notification goes out to the consultant who's traveling, saying, okay, this is your travel itinerary, this is the hotel you're going to stay, this is your rental car or your taxi, your pickup, and this is how much you're going to get in per diem. And all that is now tracked, and all that data is now managed. We have all that data so that we can use it for reporting as well, right, which will lead me into the next example, which is basically profitability analysis, which is our finance team does. So, because we are open source, but we also need to make money, right? So it's a business, and we usually make money out of our support business and some of it from the consulting engagements. So when it comes to profitability, especially at the end of a quarter, at the moment we have someone who spends about 3 to 4 weeks on manual effort to calculate this now. Right, so again, this is something in progress because he needs to go and look at the consulting allocation document that I spoke about earlier and look at all the consulting records there. If someone is allocated to a support for a particular week or two or a month, then he needs to go and look and see for those 3 months who was in support. Then he needs to go and look at the travel spreadsheet. He needs to go and look at the payroll document because what we need calculating the cost, he will say, okay, this person was allocated for 2 weeks. So then we need to proportionately calculate his HR cost, right? So you need to look at that, and he has to go and look at NetSuite as well to pick up any additional costs, like any overheads and all that you need to do a proper profitability calculation. So that whole process, because of the volume that we have, because we have about probably about 80 consultants traveling at any given time, it just takes 3 to 4 weeks. Again, it's not scalable, and this poor guy can be actually adding much more value using his knowledge and his skills in the finance area without just number crunching all this for 4 weeks. So this is something we are changing at the moment. It's not scalable. So what we are doing here now is we are using the two applications that we have. All that data that got orchestrated through the systems is now in our consultant allocation app. It's in our travel app. What we are doing now is going to get it into a format that we can pump it into the NetSuite journals. as a cost with all the other information that's required, pump it into NetSuite, and through NetSuite, we will get it out into a data analytics server, do any correlation that's required so that we can come up with a financial dashboard now, which will automatically give us the a margin analysis, so you should be able to slice and dice the records, and hopefully in real time. We want to bring that time down drastically. So this is some other activity that's happening. So we are, for operational efficiency, we are basically relying a lot on dashboards and metrics now. So we have all these systems in place. We have a scheduled process running to collect all that data through ESB connectors. We have ESB connectors built for all of these, through Enterprise Service Bus into our own data store. And through that data store, now we are going to get it into, this is already working in some areas, to data analytics server where we do the correlation. So sample correlation would be, so we sell development support, right? So development support, when we sell, let's say for example, we sell 500 hours to a customer of development support, we will have a record in Salesforce saying we sold 500 hours to this customer, but Salesforce doesn't tell us how much is used already. That is in Jira. So now we have a dashboard that tells us, a dashboard component that tells us, okay, this customer bought 500, he has 150 remaining, which we didn't have. It had some manual effort to be done before this. So that type of correlation is now possible, where we collect all that data through data analytics server and come up with the dashboards. And so what's more, we also project those dashboards, so we have some screens or monitors in certain areas. We are connected to a Raspberry Pi, we are using IoT server to configure and say, okay, this particular set of dashboards needs to go to these screens. And this, for example, finance, it's sensitive material, it can't go to everyone, right? So we control that to IoT server to say where that data should go. These are some of the dashboards that we've done. That's for the build, so that's basically telling us what our build status is for our products. Over the week, basically the last 7 days, for each of the products. Then this is a product dashboard that we've created. So the product dashboard actually has 6 integrations coming in. So someone who wants to go and look at details of a particular product to see what's happening, he will have in one single place. If it's API manager, he'll be able to say what the build status is over the last 7 days, what's the release plan, what's the issue counts in Jira, how are things in GitHub. We'll have a record in GitHub. We're also going to integrate it to Salesforce so that we know for API manager, we have this many production instances running, we have this many customers running. So a product lead or an engineer or anyone who's interested in the product can just go and look at that page now and say, okay, this is the total view for my product and something is not right, because he'll have all the graphs and the data, and then some financial dashboards as well. So this is stores. So we are using our own store product, our enterprise store product, for some of our, so basically the store.wso2.com is where we advertise all our connectors. We have ESB connectors and identity server authenticators that are already in there. So we are using our own product, the store product, to advertise that. And within our organization, we have our application in App Manager. So I think Sumedh is going to be talking about that further in the next session. Where we advertise our own applications to our staff, so they don't need to go and create bootmarks. They if they come here, it will be categorized into the different areas. They'll know exactly what to go and click on, and it's all single sign-on. As I said earlier, once you're logged into App Manager, you're logged into all the applications that you need access to. Right. So there are a lot more things that we are thinking about internal now in terms of improving efficiency and within the organization. And obviously, we are using our own, as I said, we are relying on our own dog food here. And because I would also like you to think about the possibilities, because we have so much of integrations that we can do. We can connect to almost anything. We have about 150 connectors that are in our marketplace now. If there's no connector, you can just let us know, because we can build that, we can add it to our roadmap and give it some priority. Or if you want, you can build your own connector yourself, because there's a comprehensive documentation and a framework that you can do, and if you want, you can contribute it to our community as well. And then once you have that in place, you can you know, expose those as APIs to your suppliers or, you know, across departments, so that you can build other applications and integrate them. And then you can use identity server for very granular level security features, analytics from streaming analytics to predictive analytics, expose those as mobile applications or, you know, come up with dashboards. So basically, for all automations that we are using, as I said, except for some third-party libraries that we are using for, you know, for the graphical components, basically everything is WSO2 now. So in summary, you know, the more systems that you start having in your enterprise IT landscape is definitely going to cause some operational issues, and it's going to cause, you know, result in a disgruntled employee. So if you just take a step back, think about the integrations that you can do and how you can automate and orchestrate that data across your systems and provide that the best use experience for your users. And obviously WSO2 has all the tools and the help that you can do to achieve this. Thank you.